Jones Show, the visionary behind this film, groundbreaking director and producer, Ava DuVernay.
My sister friend.
Yay.
Oh,
you're here.
I'm here.
Hi.
Hi. That was fun.
Warrior of the light.
Yes.
Oh.
Definitely.
That's nice.
You're
Thank
a big
you.
Warrior of the light.
Thank you. We try.
Can I tell you that I wanted to be her friend? Okay, you don't have to ask.
Go, go.
Can I just tell you? I wanted to be her friend. So I saw her movie, Middle of Nowhere, and I wanted to be her friend.
Back in the early one.
Yes.
Early.
And so I don't like go around looking for friends.
That's probably true.
Okay. So I wanted to be a friend, but so I Googled her and I saw this picture of the glasses and the face and I thought, wow, what a warm, engaging, but I'm going to be her friend.
Yes.
So I set out to be her friend.
Wow, it's inspiring.
And it worked. And it worked.
It was hard. I know it's tough for you, but
definitely. It's an incredible story. Whenever I hear her say that, I just can't even believe it, you know, from a Google picture. Yeah. Thank goodness I wore my glasses that day.
Yeah. Yeah.
Girls with glasses.
Yeah. Girls with glasses.
You know, Ava, you could have really done anything. After Selma, then you did the 13th. Why did you pick this project to be the next kind of anchor in the Ava DuVernay body of work?
I fell in love with the story about this girl, Meg, being a hero. The idea that she could fly, hop planets, save the universe. She's not a Jedi, she's not a superhero. She's a regular girl in a plaid shirt and glasses. And that she could do things that she thought she didn't have inside of her. Do things that she thought was impossible. And I relate to that. I didn't pick up a camera until I was 32 years old. I didn't go to film school. I was a black woman trying to make film at that late age. And if in film, that's old. It's like dog years. It's like very old. And so achieving the impossible, like I really saw something in Meg's story that connected with me. But then also after 13th, I was tired of darkness. You know what I mean? That was 1,000 hours of racist, violent footage that I had to look through and carve and craft. I just went to go, design flowers for 2 years. And so I did. It was fun to work with friends and share a message of light.
What you mentioned one time, Oprah, that you saw Sidney Poitier on television and it just changed your life. Mm-hmm. What would an 11-year-old Oprah Winfrey have been like if she could have seen this movie?
I wouldn't have believed it was possible. Don't make me start crying here. Because the very thought of the idea that there is an Ava for them to see, and I've told this story before, but it's true. There were so few role models when I was coming up that every month I would go to the store and get 17 magazine, because my family was on welfare, my mother was on welfare, so I could never afford a subscription. So I would only have the 50 cents, so I would wait there. And there was not a brown person ever in all the years that I was buying 17 magazine. There was one white girl who had brown hair and a round nose. Her name was Colleen Corby, and I used to pull her out of the magazine and put those pictures on the wall.
Representation.
For representation.
As close as she could get.
Because it was as close as I could get.
Did you have her on your show?
And I years later had her on my show to say, you were it
all,
for me.
All we had.
You were as close to black as I could get. I was a brunette.
I don't want to have any spoilers on the movie, but I got to talk to you because just the opening of the movie, you have this young brown-skinned girl who's being trained not to bake cookies, not to play with dolls, but it looks like she's being trained to be like the world's greatest scientist. Like just the opening of the movie, I'm like, Ava can roll the credits right now, because just that image is going to just do, I mean, I've never seen in my life that image. How important was it to you to show her as not just a beautiful girl, though she's beautiful, but also this incredibly intellectually gifted prodigy?
Well, it was very important, but I don't think there's anything wrong with baking cookies and playing with dolls.
Sure.
I think we need to just have balance and we need to have options.
Yes.
That's always been the challenge, is that women have been put in one box, that this is all you can do. Those things are great and they require intellect and creativity.
Yes.
But in addition, you can also be a mathematician and an astrophysicist and a doctor in actually anything you want. And that's the goal of the story.
Yeah. I also think that this movie is subversive in a different way. You said already, she's fighting evil, but she's not throwing roundhouse kicks. She doesn't pull out a ray gun. She's not got a lightsaber. She figures out a way to fight based on the love she has for her brother, for her father, for herself. Are you trying to change the way that, expand the way that heroism works in cinema? Is that, you up to something?
Well, I don't know. This is a movie for young people, yeah. And people who are young at heart can still tap into that space where you have a hopeful heart. I mean, these are dark and divisive times, and I was listening to you. You know, I reach for my phone first thing in the morning, too, and it just sets the day off in a bad way if you look at the wrong account and who tweeted in the middle of the night. And so you just
told you.
And she always tells me not to do it. But one of the things that's really that I've learned from her is you can fight with light. For example, when President Trump was tweeting at her.
You called to tell me.
I called to tell you. And I said, so what are we going to do? And she said, nothing. Of course not. Of course we don't do anything. And I'm going to go have a latte and walk around the garden. Yeah. You know what I mean? Like, really just...
I'm going to take my dogs out.
Yeah, it's just about where you put your energy. And so this film, and a lot of what I'm trying to think of these days, is you put your energy in places that are seeds that blossom into beautiful things instead of putting your energy into things that only drag you down.
That's what I'm trying to tell you.
would you want to maybe teach that to President Trump? In other words, you guys know each other. Listen, seriously, hold on. You all are laughing. Hold on.
What is he talking about?
I see pictures.
I have not spoken to President Trump since he became President Trump. The last time I saw him was we were in a restaurant, I think 2016, and you know that Ralph Lauren's restaurant, and there were a whole bunch of people in the restaurant, and he was at a table, and I was at a table. So when you say know each other,
yeah
okay,
hello. This is a serious question. I think about this because of this whole idea of light. If you had 10 minutes with him, mm-hmm. I mean, you're one of the few people, listen, billionaire to billionaire, megastar to megastar, and also human being to human being, what would you say to a president? No cameras, no lights, just you guys.
I would only speak where I feel that I can be heard. So I would only speak if I felt that I could be heard. All right?
No. Sure. If all you were doing was making these amazing films, or, you know, Queen Sugar, this amazing TV show, that would be it.
Season 3.
So listen, if that's all you're doing, that would be enough. But you've gone so far beyond that. You had only female directors for one of the seasons of
all the seasons.
Yeah. Only female directors. Only, and you're fighting. You've said over and over again, if being the first is nothing, if you're the last, and you've been fighting. Talk about this inclusion revolution that you're helping to lead in Hollywood.
Oh, I don't think I'm leading it. I think I'm a part of it.
I think you are. I have to interrupt you because the word inclusion actually came from you.
That's true.
Yes.
I mean, you were saying diversity and I was saying, let's say inclusion.
Everybody was saying diversity and then I saw you said inclusion. I'm like, it's inclusion.
But it wasn't.
No, it's inclusion. Okay.
But I mean, I love Frances McDormand. She talked about this inclusion writer, and this is this idea that's going on around in Hollywood.
It was
really an idea that actors and producers and directors who really care about this idea of there being an inclusive crew, all kinds of people being able to make the movies, both the directors in front of the camera and the crew members, like these wonderful camera people here behind the cameras. We want those kind of people to look like the real world, that the stars of the film would put in their contracts. If you want me, you have to have an inclusive crew. So it's an inclusion writer in the contracts.
I'm noticing something. The Me Too movement started by a black woman. Black Lives Matter started by 3 black women. You have you guys sitting here. The Alabama was won, that Senate race was won because of black women. Did the black women have a meeting? Did you guys get together and just say we're going to change and say, because it's like something has happened. Am I wrong?
It's in our bones.
We shining a spotlight on the forgotten voices of the Me Too movement and the Time's Up movement. When we get back, it's an issue that's really important to all three of us. That's next on The Van Jones Show, when we get back. And the director of Wrinkle in Time. It's in theaters right now. Go out and see it. You know a man named Shaka Singhore.
Oh, yeah.
And
Writing My Wrongs.
Right. The author, beautiful, brilliant author, yeah. Writing My Wrongs, did 17 years in prison, 7 years in solitary confinement, came out, became an MIT fellow, became a best-selling author, met you. He always talks about what he learned from you. But what did you learn from Shaka Singhore?
I learned that you are not the biggest mistake you've ever made. I learned that redemption is possible. I learned that within every single person is this desire to be seen and heard and valued for who you truly know yourself to be and who you know yourself to become. And he taught me a lot about not judging people, because I had the book on my desk. Somebody had said, you should interview this guy. And I was like, it's big. I was like, what am I going to learn from him? This is a guy who murdered someone. And then as I was packing up to leave Chicago, I carried the book and then ended up reading the book and was so moved by his story that he's become a friend of mine. That's and beautiful. So it helped me to drop judgment.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. And to see things, to see everybody differently. I mean, because of his story.
Because of his story. Mm-hmm. You know, and Ava, mm-hmm. you're somebody, you know, that you made the documentary, The 13th, and Shaka was in your documentary.
You were too.
Well, I was too. I appreciate that.
You're in a lot.
But just say a word about why you went into creating a documentary like The 13th about prisons.
Well, I want to create a primer. It's not just about prison. It's about, as you well know, it's about the criminal justice system and the ways in which what we call the prison industrial complex now has been morphed and formed and deformed as the decades have gone on. So in that documentary, we spend 100 minutes and we go through 100 years of American history and really help people understand that prison isn't just a place where bad people go, that it's much deeper than that. It's very insidious. And it's a system that needs to be really looked at in all of its layers. There's not going to be one politician or one bill that fixes it.
Yeah. Well, listen, I agree with you 100%, and I want to show you something. I've been trying to figure out what's going on with women in our prison system, and I think you're going to be shocked when you see what I found. Check.